we'll pray together. May your word, Lord, penetrate our hearts and minds and bring transformation in our lives. By the grace of your Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Wonderful scripture readings this morning. I really enjoyed them. Anyway, Leonardo DiCaprio, do you know him? Have you seen movies by him? Angelina Jolie. They are both very famous actors in Hollywood. And Leonardo is reported to earn about 20 to 25 million US dollars per movie. I mean, he plays one of the roles. Per movie, he gets that kind of money. And Angelina is known to earn up to 33 million. Now, this is one example of human living. Another one is quite different. In Colombo, you can see a woman who works for a barn. She walks around with a cart and a broom. And the woman walks like she needs a double hip replacement. Just watching her move ahead is painful. Now, when Leonardo and Angelina get a bit tired between shoots, there's always a place for them to go and retire. And there will be cool water, or there will be any other choice of drinks. And of course, carefully selected snacks that are sure not to put any unsightly weight on their perfect bodies. But what about this Abans lady? For her, there's no private cool place to provide her any kind of sustenance as she goes about her dirty work. And I wonder, doesn't it seem obscene to you that people who enjoy the work that they do are paid much more than they need? While, for example, an uneducated single mother, really anywhere in the world, will be holding down two jobs, both backbreaking and unfulfilling, and she barely manages to cover the cost of running a home. Take a moment to think. Do you believe that God is happy with, or that God is even accepting of this kind of world order, where some people have enormous riches while others are destitute and are not even able to provide food and shelter and education and health care for their children? Do you think God is pleased with this? Do you think that he accepts that? Now, when I read the Song of Mary this time around, you know, every time you read it, something new kind of comes to you. You see something new. And what leapt off the page and grabbed my attention were really two themes. The first was that I was astounded to find that this young woman, Mary, never complained in any way about the costs of this unorthodox pregnancy, the cost for her. How it looked like it was going to ruin everything that she had expected of life. She doesn't say anything about that. And secondly, what is so obvious in this song is that she presents us with God's world order, which is completely and totally at odds with the world as we know it and as many of us live it. Now, let me start with the second observation. Mary says that God, as he restores his order of this world, will send the rich empty away and fill the hungry with good things. Now, as I was trying to imagine what will this look like, I thought that you can imagine Leonardo and Angelina being met with a no entry sign when they come to rest between shoots. But where they catch enough of a glimpse of the inside of what they consider their hideaway and see that their private space has been taken by a woman with bad hips from Colombo, and she has finally been given a chance to put her feet up. That's what it looks like. Now, God created the world So he is the one who has had all of the ideas about what a good world looks like, what it really is. And he said in the beginning of the Bible, as we find it recorded in Genesis, he said to Adam, "Behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed which is upon the face of the earth, and I have given you every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food." Now, if Adam and Eve were like most modern people, they would immediately upon hearing this have put some signs up on every tree and on every plant, you know, these fluorescent signs that says how much you have to pay and so on, because they would make sure that they were going to make personal profit for any use of them, wouldn't they? Isn't that how we do things? There would have been 50% and 20% and 10% signs indicating that, for example, for every one mango somebody picked, another mango had to be picked and delivered to Adam and Eve. And for every five cherries, one had to be sent to Adam and Eve, and so on. But when we read the Bible, we don't expect to see such a selfish, commercial spirit at work, do we? It's clear to us when we read the Bible that the world's resources were given to Adam and Eve to share with all future generations. And I would like us to consider this question. When did we come to change our minds about that? When did we come to change our minds about that? We could say that the world is God's house, and into his house he invites all of his creation, and in a very special way, human beings. He's put everything on the table that any guest can need, and over and above, just think of the incredible variety that this world offers. But God's guests, they have seriously messed up his original banquet. Some have put fences around big parts of the table, and they insist that no one else is allowed to eat there. And they have come to think of these sections as their sections. And usurpers of sections are even defending their territory violently, so that those who don't have access, well, they must just suffer hunger and thirst. We see that very vividly in the world, in the West's exclusion of desperate refugees these days, don't we? And let me here add something that I've been shocked to find, that many Sri Lankans living abroad, who themselves years ago sought refuge, now are so hard-hearted that they join with right-wing nationalists in their efforts to keep present refugees out. But we see the phenomenon of exclusion in this part of the world as well, where we see appalling inequalities existing closely side by side, constantly reinforced by daily practice and accepted as normal. Now, Rabbi Jonathan Sacks, being a Jew, he needs only the Old Testament to be enlightened on the issue of biblical economics. And in one of his very helpful books, he says, "Of any economic system, we must ask, does it allow everyone to participate in the material blessings of this created world? Does it allow everyone to participate? Does it sustain a climate of equal regard for the poor, no less than the rich? Does the economic system protect the vulnerable and help those in need to escape the trap of need? Do those who succeed share their blessings with those who have less? Is that how our economic system works? Does the economic system strengthen the bonds of human solidarity?" As we think of what is common today and the normal way of thinking about economics, I think we should really listen to these kind of questions. Isn't it a tragedy that we have so little respect for God and so little love in our hearts for people that fellow human beings that have been forced to live in conditions that have recently, for some of them, led to death, buried by collapsed garbage mountains in Addis Ababa, in Delhi, and even here in Colombo? Isn't that a tragedy? But we should also remember that when we say that we believe God made the world and everything in it, we are both saying that he gave all of the materials that we work with, but we are also saying that he designed our brains and the hands that we use. He's the one who invented families, he's the one who invented work and play, artistic expression, and really all imaginable human pursuits. So we can never say that we believe in God as creator of all and then consider ourselves self-made men and women. And God has decided to give all human beings, each one of us, a diverse set of gifts, talents, abilities. And his idea always was, and still is, that we use these talents and gifts and abilities to make this world a better place for everyone. Not ever that we hug what we have to our chests and privatize the profit made from our talents. And the talents that we have will provide each individual with more or less choice, more or less opportunity. And we are called to make our choices, called to use our opportunities, especially to benefit those who are deprived. Those who are deprived because of the selfish ways of so many in this world who refuse to share, who refuse to give, who refuse to help and love. And how we use our talents and gifts, in whose service we use it, for whose benefit we use them, it's evident in, for example, what we choose to and decide to study or research, what we decide to invest in, what we work on inventing, what we decide to sell, what we decide to produce, what we decide to buy, or what we decide to design. So ask yourself, where do you live and work? Where do you make your contribution? Who does your work benefit? Whose rights do you defend? What inequalities do you work to rectify? What injustices do you labor to put right? Do you put all your efforts where all want to work because there's so much to gain personally? Or do you deliberately seek out places where you can show your loyalty with those others avoid? Now, let's turn to Mary now, who at the news that she will be pregnant outside of marriage breaks out in song of praise to God. Now, I would have expected a young girl's reaction to such news, that is, if I had not read the account in Luke 1 over and over again for years, I would have expected a young girl's reaction to such news to have been completely different. I would have expected her to say to the angel and say in prayer to God, "Do you realize just how much trouble a pregnancy like this is going to put me in? How can you do this to me? This messes up my life so completely. My reputation is going to be shut. My family is disgraced. They'll never forgive me. And my marriage to Joseph is definitely not going to happen. What a mess you're making of my life. Can't you find somebody else? Why me? I just want to have a life. Is that too much to ask? And I could imagine her to go on to say, now, but if there is absolutely no way out of this, can you just make sure to fly over to Joseph and to my parents and tell them what you just told me? They will never believe me otherwise. And could you also blow a trumpet from heaven and give the news with a loud voice so that the village knows that I've not been sleeping around, please? Now, the only possible reason why Mary responded with praise to God would be that she had already given her life to him, because she had already accepted that her life was not her own. Her life was already dedicated to be lived for God's praise and glory and for God's world order. And I want to ask us today that if that is not where we are at, are we really Christians in the true sense of that word? Do we complain that following Jesus and giving up privileges that others grab, that's too painful for us? Do we say to God, you are asking too much? Or do we say and think and feel and express with young Mary that it is a privilege to serve God, that it's a privilege to serve God's world order? Now, just allow me to take another turn here. There are people among us today who are seriously ill, some facing death. Let me say a little bit about that. Now, I do not for a moment believe that God is the author of sickness and death. I believe that these are evils that destroy God's good creation. Because what good is there about a body ripped apart by disease, or a person torn away from those they dearly love? These are examples of the evil that we saw Jesus combat when he was on earth, as he constantly was healing the sick and even raising the dead. But I also think that though sickness and death are evil and not a call of God like what Mary was receiving, I think we can still learn from Mary in our situation. For us, as for her, we do not have to complain and say, why me? But we can remember that God and his world order is still central, even at this time of suffering. And we can say things like, well, better me than someone without a safe and comfortable house. Better me than someone who cannot afford good medical care. Better me than someone without friends and family to support them. Even in extreme situations, we can remember that we are the privileged in a world where so many are seriously deprived. I find it very distressing that of the few books on suffering and death that you find in Christian bookstores generally, most, if not all, they speak about the sufferings of well-off Christians and not about those who are buried by garbage mountains. We are really not helped by such books as well-off Christians to keep our personal suffering in perspective. We are not helped to keep our suffering in perspective. Like Mary, we must remember God's glory and the poor, even when life is tough. And I have a third point, I have a final point, but don't worry, it's extremely short. It is a third observation on the Song of Mary. I cheated you. I didn't have two, I had three. Okay. But in the final verses of Mary's song, Mary triumphantly says that God coming in human flesh in Jesus was to be a fulfillment of God's promises, especially to the Jews. What a special honor for them. But we know that they rejected that honor. But I suggest that instead of pointing fingers at them, we should ask ourselves today whether we are truly willing to embrace this Jesus that they rejected. Will we embrace this Jesus that they rejected? Or will we also reject this Jesus who commands us to live according to God's world order and not like others around us? Will we also reject this Jesus who tells us not to end our lives with complaints of, why me? Will we reject Jesus for expecting too much from us? Or will we praise God together with young Mary? And will we uphold God's beautiful order, world order, in all that we do with our lives, with our money, with our abilities, and our opportunities? Now let's have a moment of silent prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now we normally after, for those of you who don't know, we normally after the 8 o'clock service have a discussion of the sermon afterwards, and that is in that building over there, in the seminar hall, air conditioned, so you'll be comfortable. I will not be able to be there, but Roel, who normally leads those meetings, and Vinod, my husband, will be there to discuss with you some of these thoughts. Thank you.